What's the way you guys firmly send here? Do not gaze so sheepishly upon me. I am your lover. But it's too potent. Such powerful incantations have rendered you an ass eternal. And I look and feel an ass remaining in my love. There must exist some remedy to your affliction. Be it three. But I must perform something, some act of courage that should dispel this spell and return thee to thine beautiful shape. It is not dignified for thee to remain in such a way that is more to life than godhood. Here I shall take leave and embark upon an adventure that shall restore thee. But it would be discourteous of me to rid thee of my affection. For if there indeed be conscience of thee left in this beast, I must assure thee that I do love it with all mine heart, even if it plagues me so. Accept this kiss as token of my lasting love and of my evergreen grief that I shall be fueled by on my journey. No! No, I'm not kissing the goat guy! I can't! Look, I just... This can't be entertaining for anyone. You liking look at it so far. Yeah, I'm talking to you. I'm no longer so spat a lot. What do you think? Ooh, let's go to the theatre tonight, darling. Why is that, honey? Oh, well, there's a medieval drama on. Will a man kiss a goat in it?
I should think so. What's the point without?
Of course not! Can't you see? It's completely meaningless. It's nothing dressed up as something.
Oh, what? You think I mean stupid?
Oh! You think you can take something from this? A little lesson in a gift bag. There's nothing here. Imagine aliens looking down, coming down and looking at this. A load of people sat in an ascending series of chairs, facing some more people, pretending to be different people. Completely functionless. Especially when the pretending people have to force themselves to say shit like, "Do not gaze so sheepishly upon me." For a start, that is a terrible pun. Secondly, so go for a sheep! All I'm saying is you can't just buy meaning. You can't pay a ticket price for a room in which people strut and fret about on a stage and then expect to gain some insight about where to take your life. Why are you still going? It's over, mate. I'm not doing it anymore. Jesus Christ, it's worse than I thought. Why would you keep going? What's the motive? Look at you. Look at how stupid you look. You're a fully grown man. And yet there you are, bleating on the ground covered in cotton. Look at all these people watching you. Life's tough, I get it. But what cruel fortune have you had to make you persist in this barnyard behaviour? You don't have to do this. I've had enough. Look at me. I'm better than this. And you are certainly better than that. You deserve some dignity. Let's go for bigger jobs. Maybe you actually contribute to the world.
What are you doing?
Jesus Christ, where the first fuck did you come from?
What are you doing?
What does it look like I'm doing? I'm quitting. Something I should have done the first time I ever acted.
Man, I knew this would happen.
Oh, sure you did. Guessing that's the wisdom of the old bearded fruit funneling through your trunk.
Stop dicking about. These people have come here for entertainment, not the postmodernist deconstruction of the medium of performance. I've got targets. Go back to doing your job. Stop being such a child because you're ruining this for the rest of us.
You've worked hard on this.
Yeah, we all have.
As far as I'm aware, you're a tree.
only say, like, one line when the woodland comes alive for no discernible reason.
I also wrote the bloody thing.
Oh. Well, sir, birch would better bark than bite. I am sorry your brain can concoct such irrelevant nonsense.
See, that's where the problem begins. This is not irrelevant.
What if you're going to try and persuade me that this has some deeper application? Like the goat is a metaphor for oppressed minorities living as goats.
No, the goat is a symbol for your own narcissism.
What?
Melisandre is Cassandra, and the goat is the obstacles that you put... That's who I based Melisandre on. Your breakup was the inspiration for this entire play. Cassie left here because she wanted to do those weird avant-garde movies, and in your eyes, it became irrelevant, so she became stupid. Something to be saved by you and your superior life knowledge.
I don't know what you're saying.
What does the knight do when he finds the cure?
He turns her back into a woman.
And what does she say?
Some shit about wood.
She says, thou art a truly knavish wooden head that do convert me so. Meaning, you're an idiot. She wanted to be a goat. She was happy as a goat. It was her life's dream to be a goat.
If it was her life's dream to be a goat, why didn't she tell the knight he loved her?
For the same reason Cassie didn't tell you about her acting. She knew what the reaction would be. We've all seen this in you. This snobbery, this pretentiousness. We were going to drop you. And I thought, no, I can use this. So I wrote a play perfectly describing your situation because I thought it would really lift your acting.
This whole play is about me.
Yeah.
You think Cassie left me because I didn't like her act.
Yeah, but I think you knew that already.
But I made a good point. This is me and all of it. It doesn't mean anything.
Why?
Well, just look at this guy.
Man!
And there's nothing meaningful going on in his life. He's literally bleating out in front of an audience.
And that's supposed to mean something, is it?
No. Doesn't mean anything. That is my point. It just frustrates me how you all sit there and pretend to care about this, thinking that if you just go to the theatre every once in a while, you can consider yourselves intelligent. You pretend harder than we do.
No one is pretending, except from you and the goat.
I'm not pretending anymore.
Yes, you are. You've memorized more lines for this argument than you have my entire play. You're going around pretending to care about the higher function of theatre when all you really care about is yourself. And that is okay, by the way, caring about yourself. It's all anyone really does, but you're pretending this isn't about you, and it's painful to watch. You're going around telling everybody that their life is meaningless because your life has lost meaning. Your girlfriend left you because you were in love with a version of her that only existed in your mind. And you realised that your dream job wasn't actually something you wanted to do. This one here in the script, the knight, was going to leave his job, but then he thought, no, I'm going to carry on in the hopes of finding as many knights as possible and explaining how terrible their life's choices were.
All right. I suppose with your woodland wisdom, you've got a solution.
Yeah, I do. You need to get carried away.
What does that even mean?
Lose yourself in the moment. Look at this guy. He is not worried about the meaning of life. He's just getting on living it.
He looks like an idiot.
Does he? Does he? I'd say compared to you, he looks pretty clever right now. And your accusations about the audience pretending to be intelligent because they go and watch plays, that is stupid. It is fine to be sad about Cassie. Heck, I miss Cassie, but the only way out is to pick yourself up and actually make an effort in your life instead of shitting on everybody else's existence. If you want to quit, fine. You can take your nihilism somewhere else. I think what everybody needs right now is for you to forget yourself. Become someone sensible and let go.
You haven't listened to me at all.
Well, I want this bloody play about you. Now get yourself some dignity. Pick your sword and your shield up. You have the opportunity to give the best performance of your life. You can fall in love with a goat because you're already in love with it. But you might find, in those moments, life doesn't need to mean anything. It doesn't need some higher function. The meaning is the moment. Just go. Make your choice. And you, the audience, you're going to remember what happened here, and I can't stop you. But I ask you to put it out of your minds. I've worked hard on this script because I think it's worth your time. So please, lose yourself. Get carried away. Forget life. The knight was right. There is more to life than goathood. But where would we be without it?
Russians and Germans?
You phrase bon voyage, auf Wiedersehen.
Africa.
No more.
China. Even New Zealand?
No, they're fine.
Oh, really? Is everyone dead? The bloody Kiwi survived, and he was alive.
Yes, it's just us and the New Zealanders that helped survive. Everyone else is dead.
Was it,
We're not sure.
Ready or what?
I'm not certain who sent the first tweet.
Tweet? Was it tweet that started it?
Yes. Things seem to have escalated quite quickly.
Quite quickly? I've only been asleep for a few hours.
Well, it happened within a couple of minutes.
And they go and destroy everyone, though.
We knew there were problems going to happen.
Yeah, but not the whole bloody world. Well, us and the Kiwis. Not even one missile was fired at us.
Not to our knowledge, no.
Why not?
It seems like they forgot about us.
What do you mean they forgot about us?
Everyone had missiles pointing at everyone else, but none were pointing at us.
Must have been quite the display. Bit rude though, isn't it? I mean, maybe one was aimed at Canberra, but it's misfired or got lost along the way.
We haven't had a single report on triage. Surely we should be happy about
it? Yeah, but I find it hard to believe that they'd forget about us. When we're such an important voice on the international stage. We're vital to global politics. Well, can you please check there wasn't a little one that went off on some remote part of the coastline or something?
I'll check, but we're not. We're certain that there was not.
But not 100%.
99%.
Yeah, but not 100%.
As much as I appreciate your enthusiasm for details, we need action now.
Sure. What is it the PM needs from me?
The Prime Minister was unfortunately in Bali when the missiles were launched.
Even Bali was bombed and not us.
Really?
fatal.
So,
what do you want me?
It's not up to me to decide.
Okay. What? All right, fine. What is it we need to do?
The nation looks to you. We need you to decide what happens next.
Yeah, and what's that?
I think, personally, we should figure out a way to tell people.
Tell them? Not sure how that'll go.
What?
Well, my experience is anything to go by in such a situation. I'd rather not know it's just us and the bloody Kiwis left behind. Barney's pop. We're in a holiday now.
How are we going to keep the news from the people, sir?
Just don't play the news today.
Don't you think people will notice if the news doesn't go there?
Just play reruns.
Reruns of the news?
Yes, look, we've got decades of news. I'm sure we can whip up a few old episodes. Why are you writing that down?
News reruns.
Right, now, what about the Facebook? Can we delete that?
Switched off.
Okay. Don't have to worry about it leaking out then, will we?
Guess not, sir.
I knew it was going to be a grim day when you woke me up this morning. Oh well. Best get on with our lives. I mean, it's all a bit of a relief, really.
Sir?
It's getting a little noisy up there. Coughing?
Website, see? There just so happens to be a couple of women on there showing their tattoos, but I was looking at the tattoos.
You sure that's all you were looking at?
You want to look at the history of where I've been? You always want to look at what I look at.
What I don't see you looking for is a job.
I look for one today.
For what, like 2 minutes?
Don't start up with me. I'll get a headache.
All your headaches are actually headaches.
I do not want to get sucked into one of these old arguments.
We wouldn't get into these arguments if you got a job.
We wouldn't get into these arguments
but
if you didn't start
you
them.
Sit on your ass
but
all
I
time.
Do not sit on my... Check goes to pay the rent here. I don't see how you can afford to.
We could afford to move out and stuff if you got a job. Instead, you spend all day looking at tattoos, and you haven't even got the money to get any more. You spent all day looking at tattoos?
No, I did not. As a matter of fact, I was researching atmospheric phenomena. But we can't get into an argument because it'll bring the storm closer.
It's nonsense.
I read online, okay?
Wait, you just don't want to talk about our problems.
We'll talk about them later.
No, not right now. I'm tired of this. gonna talk about this right now.
No. Because you're too hot and upset, and we ain't gonna be able to discuss things calmly and rationally. But in any way, it's downright dangerous to get into an argument with a thundercloud overhead. It can create a tornado.
You are so full of shit.
Well, there is a website I showed you that suggests that...
You know what? I got a suggestion. I'm going to take this computer and put it over here. And when you're ready to talk...
Just listen to me, all right? Okay? And I'll explain. Put your hand up to my mouth, and I'll prove this. Put your hand up to my mouth.
I might be tempted to slap you.
Just put your hand up to my mouth, okay? Now, what do you feel?
Hot air.
And what does hot air do?
It rises?
Exactly.
That don't prove nothing.
Look, all right? Now, when someone talks and walks around, because the hot air that they release will start going around, and it's got nowhere to go but up. So up, it spins.
Tornado starts crumbling. Storming from down, they don't start
right. So you've got all this hot air spinning all the way around, and it's got nowhere to go but up. So up it spins, and when it gets stuck under a thundercloud, it gets caught there, spinning and spinning.
One person walking around spotting a lot of hot air ain't enough to cause no tornado.
It ain't one. It's all the heat. Look. See them metal trailers out there? Hundreds of them. And when the sun beats on them all day, they get hotter than a frying pan. And the people inside get hot, and the heat makes them cranky. So they're fussing and fighting because their wives spend too much damn
their
money.
Their husbands spend all day drinking.
Okay. So they're fussing and fighting and starting to spin in hot air, which goes out into the air vent and starts mixing and spinning with the heat from the metal outside. So you got all this hot air rising and spinning every which way. And when it gets stuck under a thundercloud, there's a cyclone forms. And that turns into a cyclone, which starts spinning all the way down, sucking up the hot air, because that is the quickest way for the heat to rise. So you've got this cyclone spinning all the way down to where it's the hottest. An overheated trailer park, and that is why tornadoes always hit trailer parks.
Twisters hit trailer parks at random.
It ain't random. It's because of hot air spewing economic disadvantage from living in overheated mobile homes have stupid, pointless, circular arguments.
Well, we would not be having a stupid, pointless, circular argument if you got a job.
Don't start an argument with me.
You're starting one with me.
I'm just trying to explain the scientific evidence.
Subject.
The subject is tornado physics.
Oh, the subject is you being a lazy bum.
I do not want to get sucked into one of those old arguments.
Well, then quit yelling and raising your voice.
You're the one yelling at me. You got to understand, okay? Listen.
You make me so
tornado,
angry.
Tornado
I don't listen to your
physics,
bullshit
okay?
anymore.
When the
whole
act slams
into one.
So I race home to tell me that. See, he's always dreamt of going daffodils and selling at the markets. But with Mummy being sick all those years, he's always been home to care for her. So I charge through the thick cigarette-smoking dad's bed, stepping over empty beer bottles, screaming, "Hurry yourself! Get dressed, Daddy! We're leaving now to claim your land!" And he just lays in there, staring at nothing like he's been for it. I bring it to his bed, singing our usual silence. That night, I grab a torch, and I sneak out the bedroom. The swamp lady,
fairy trees, each one more than 100 years old. The branches reaching out with the twisted fingers of old hands. Of course, Irish legend has it, it's terrible bad luck to even make a tiny branch of a fairy tree. Because angry fairies will seek revenge. That's why you see these farmer's kids with the lone fairy tree stones piled up around the base. Just to make sure no one accidentally goes into it. How can the Irish still believe in things with wings or superstition or even a god? Is it any of that for true? My mummy'd still be alive. If it's not some ramshackle college, it would be my answer, isn't it? What do you want? I yell, we'll take it! The door creeps open. The old woman squints at me through the bifocals. Boy, 'tis here land is cursed, full of angry wee fairies. My husband chopped down a fairy tree, I warned him, so I did. For sure, he couldn't be told about luck. One day, he was crossing the road, and her eyes stare off into the garden, she hands me a contract to give to my daddy. The next day, I forged that signature back to the cottage. Places of ours. Now, I'm not saying I wasn't fitting a wee bit as I held that axe above my shoulder, staring at that thick trunk. And then I thought about the cancer that ate my mother's body. And all the chemotherapy and vegetable juices, doctors, and dragged out her suffering. I felt to watch her die a little more each day, knowing all we could do. We had never cut down a fairy tree or walked under a ladder and put new shoes on the kitchen table. We were good people who did good things. This is how we were punished. So I drive that axe into that fairy tree. It barely pierces the bark. So I yell, swinging harder, driving the cold steel deep into the tree's belly. Chop after chop, each one harder than the last. I barely have the strength for me to start with hope. But you know something? I didn't cross the road and get hit by a car. None of the wind people attacked me in the middle of the night. So every day after school, I go back and chop down another fairy tree. Until I was coming forward a bit dead. But company after company, the hard grown men quick. And you thought to lay a finger on them. So I burn them off. And wait for the winter rain to wash the fields from black to green. Parent teacher, and I like that. Telling them that he has to go with all the mums and dads have been there. Help him dress in front of the mirror, just like he used to dress me. Straighten his tie, combing his whiskers, grey hair. There's a front door that opens, swings into the blue sky. He hasn't seen you over 2 years. Legs so neck, wraps an arm around mine. She flew past the blue stare without staring, or hope I even get back to their friends and family. And say, will you never believe who I saw today? You wouldn't know anyone wasn't dead, God love him. And then Daddy stops as he sees it. His ease washes over him. He claps a sullen smile. Beautiful feelings that feel swing gently. Close his eyes, sniffing the sweet breeze. Maybe he's thinking of me in their first date when he gave her daffodils. Or he lived on a coffin. I say to Daddy, it's ours. I planted them so Mommy could look down from heaven and see how much we love her. His face drops as I explain how I chopped down all the fairy trees. It's okay. It's just a dumb Irish myth. There's no such thing as bad luck. Nothing's happened to us, right? With tears in his eyes, he lays a hand on my shoulder and says, I cut down a fairy tree on the spot where we built our house. Thank you.
I did, though.
I wish you hadn't, though.
I did, though, sis.
Well, if you say it again...
Your boyfriend's a knob.
Thanks for your opinion, but it's a little late.
It's not too late.
It is too late. I'm 35.
Just because you're 35, it doesn't mean you have to marry a knob.
My room needs a knob.
Babies are overrated. You can buy the contents of a knob from a little test tube this day. You don't have to marry it.
Hang on, Richard's not a knob.
Don't get married. Don't have babies. He's got me. We can spend the rest of our life partying at G-A-Y. And you can even bring your woman.
Jessica, Roots, Annika, they've all got babies. I saw this teenager on the bus the other day with a baby. The smug cow. If I bumped into someone from school, I just see their eyes darting all around me like, sorry, where's the pram? Are you hiding your baby somewhere? Have you lost your baby? I swear I'm the only person my age in the whole world without a baby!
I don't have a baby, and it doesn't matter how much sex I have, I'll never get anyone pregnant. I'm happy enough, sis. It's got to be all I know.
Look, I just can't go to another baby shower as a singleton. Annika's so far ahead of me. She's already got married, had two children, and got a divorce.
No, you can't live your life like that. You can't live on everyone's expectations and thoughts of you. Look at me. Where would I be if I bowed down to what I thought about other people? Married to a woman with 2.4 children?
It's different.
It's really not that different. Look, people are stupid. Break free! And anyway, why don't you become a lesbian? I mean, we just got tips anyway.
What makes you think he's a knob?
I don't think so too.
What? That's not true.
Son, don't you think it sounds like Richard is being a bit of an aubergine emoji?
Aubergine emoji. I know what the aubergine emoji means!
It's a big one.
Sorry, what precisely makes Richard a knob? I mean, what's your problem? Look, he's not a knob. He's nice. He's potty trained. Look, he's okay.
That's the problem. I'm only saying Richard is a knob to actually try and put you off, but that's the actual problem. He is more than okay. You don't spring to life when you talk about him. Your eyes don't dance with glee at the thought of spending every waking moment with him. And I'm sure he doesn't realize just how special you are. You're rushing into this because you're desperate to get married.
Not desperate to get married. It's him. Should I call it off?
It's up to you, sis.
I think you're right. I'm being pressured into this dream of the perfect life, the perfect wedding, and the perfect marriage. It won't be perfect if it's not the perfect guy.
Don't marry an aubergine, Emma.
Gonna have to call him and tell him it's over. Yeah. Probably would have been too soon to propose after 3 dates, anyway.
It probably would have been like it was with Gary, Rohit, Thom, Femi, and Jahid.
Yeah.
Just call me if you think you're proposing to anyone anytime soon.
Okay. I'm not obsessed with marriage, though. Thanks, Harry. Look like a nervous
schoolgirl called upon her headmistress.
Please don't box me about Karen. Women and their rights have gotten quite out of hand.
How inconvenient.
If women ever wanted to be by themselves, all would be well. But I don't believe they do. Their instinct is to not let men be by themselves.
Yes. The destruction of club life. The new woman will not rest until it is complete. Storm the Athenian. Deal me in at Boodles, whiskey and cigars all around. We want to get in everywhere, and we shall.
You actually believe that?
My dear Morgan, one can run away from women, turn them out, or give them to them. No fourth course exists. So what's she like then, the girl? Pretty?
No, rather ordinary. Doesn't wear makeup or lipstick. Very direct in her manner.
Mannish, you mean?
Not at all. A round face, but with a softness to it. She looks directly at one. She does have a rather irritating voice.
Claire, you said she wasn't nervous. She's used to giving orders.
It's rather off-putting, Carrie, especially in regard to Bob.
Does she know that these men were sleeping with you?
No, I don't think so. Bob would have told me. No, our meeting was all very cordial, civilised, rather chilly.
Well, it is a beginning. But all my sort of self out rather tidily. You, your sweetie, and his nurse friend.
Sort itself out? If you're implying a menage a trois, Karen, I will have none of your triangular business.
It's rather practical and satisfying, really. I love Little. Little loves Ralph, and Ralph loves me. I won't have sex with Little, which doesn't suit him. He has sex with Ralph, and Ralph has sex with me. So it all balances out, doesn't it? One must learn to take people as they are, Morgan, from up from there. The only requirement is a fairly large and sturdy bed.
Please, Carriage, and spare me the details.
Don't shut your mind to it. You might find a way to sort it all out, triangularly speaking.
I could never be with a woman that way.
No, rubbish. Have your policeman Bob to urge you on?
Well, the old Essex should be running nicely now. I cleaned up the carburetor and the spark plugs and replaced the fan belt.
Whatever those are. Paul, can't you buy yourself a new motor and make Bob your chauffeur?
Oh.
It's a smart cap and spiffy uniform. Do away with all that motor engine annoyance. You can afford it.
No, ma'am. It's the old... Fixing up the old Essex is all part of the fun. A new motor car would be near being as a match.
Spoken like a born mechanic, Constable.
I'm sure it's not a problem, but your husband, Mr. Carrington, and the red-bearded gentleman are sunbathing naked in your front garden.
There is no Mr. Carrington, only Ralph and Mr. Stritch. And not to worry, the head grows quite high enough. I don't want to frighten any bicycle spinsters or holiday motorists.
But Mr. Strach is lying naked in your husband's arms. It's a awfully private business of being in public, don't you think?
Was Mr. Strach lying beard up or beard down?
Beard down, I believe.
Then you will have a very firm bottom tonight.
Right. Carrington, you would have to have a spare can of petrol, would you? I'd hate for us to get caught short crossing down.
I believe there are several cans in the shed. You're welcome to go.
Thank you. Well, it's been a pleasure meeting you, Carrington. Thanks for the beers. Bye, Mr. Morgan. We'll change the show.
We are so completely unalike, Bob and I.
That's the beauty of it, don't you see? But you found each other. Please don't walk this the man for you.
You're not just saying that.
He's lovely and he loves you. Anyone can see that. If it wasn't so gone on you, I might try to see a bit.
Is it that often?
And you really are a great bait sometimes.
I know it's not the custom thing for a young man and someone of my years.
I suppose you must find the love of police member a bit overwhelming.
It is unsettling, especially the situation, the woman and all. Love can get so awfully complicated.
Welcome to the real world, honey. We choose to love people, we can get this. Talking of the real world, Kristen, it is a curious thing, isn't it?
What is it?
The more female writers don't have affairs with female policemen.
Oh, they do, Harrington. Only not in your part of the nation. You should talk to the Midford sisters. I must be going.
Motion carried. Time to throw a few pots.
Down the station. John's going to get the police car.
Oh, right away, sir.
Now, aren't you going to ask anything about it? Look, see what's missing, evidence to
know. No, madam. This area has been carefully selected to be the trial for a new modern police force. You see, in the future, all major crimes are going to be technology related, so funding is going specifically into that area. We believe this will make us the most effective police force we can be.
I'm going to get that treatment. That's good.
I'm
getting a bit
worried. No, madam. This is a minor crime and will be dealt with at the local police station.
That doesn't seem at all good.
Please let down, madam, and we'll be off.
You're joking.
Never mind. Budget restrictions have meant we can no longer afford police cars.
Or uniforms.
This is crazy. It'll take us ages to get anywhere.
Oh, it makes complete sense. You see, speed doesn't matter with minor crimes, but fitness levels in the force have been pretty poor, and days off sick at a record high. All this exercise keeps us officers healthy, thereby resulting in further savings.
And, whilst we're carrying you there, you can think about how much more money's being saved that could be spent on solving more important crimes for more important people.
This is a joke, and I'm not going anywhere with you.
Well, if madam is dropping a reported burglary, we'll be on our way.
No, I'm not. Surely.
Just hop on, madam, and we'll be there in a jiffy.
Very well.
Officer inside, we'll help you.
Inside where? This is a hardware shop.
That is correct, madam. Budget restrictions have meant we've sold all of our local stations and now have one massive station with all the mod cons.
So why are we here?
This location has been carefully selected as it caters to all the needs of the modern police force. Minor crimes, such as the one you're reporting, will now be handled on a DIY basis. And any feedback, madam, that can be delivered to the duty officer inside. You see, Jones and I must be on our way. There was a violent assault reported yesterday that we still haven't got round to.
How did you get here so fast?
Excuse me, madam?
You were just outside.
I sense your confusion and panic's blown. You are unaware as the Constable John 709 was
a clone.
He's your clone.
No, madam. We're both clones. The original Constable John's died in the laboratory in Maidstone.
Is this all part of budget cuts?
Yes, madam. Cloning is much cheaper than training up new recruits.
Look, I don't care about any of that. Please, just say what you'll do about the burglary.
Of course, madam. What you will need is this.
Paint.
Well, not just any old paint, madam. Black paint, to be specific. You see, preventing crime is the mantra of the modern police force, and seeing as 76% of crimes happen during the day, night time, this is a perfect solution to your problem. It's really very simple. All you've got to do is apply it to the exterior of your house, and any burglar will walk past completely unaware of its very existence.
Why don't you just burgle my neighbour's house instead?
That would be for your neighbour to determine.
Are you saying my neighbour wants to be burgled? Who would want that?
Someone with too much stuff, perhaps.
And if he doesn't want to be burgled?
I suggest he gets his own pain too.
But if we all did that, how would anyone find their own house?
We suggest pacing out the distance to your home before applying the pain. It's all on the instructions on the facility.
And you really expect me to go along with this?
Ah, so you've detected a flaw in the plan. What about the 23% of crimes that happen during the daytime? Well, what you need is this little beauty!
More! Pitt! How stupid do you think I am?
Give the modern police force some credit, madam. That was black exterior paint. This is black interior paint.
And you seriously think this will solve all my problems?
Unquestionably. You see, there's nothing you can do to stop a burglar from getting into your house. But if you apply this to your little internal services, the burglar may be able to get in. But once inside, they'll be so disorientated, they'll be neither capable of fevering or leaving. The worst you'll come back to after 2 weeks in sunny New York is the rotting corpse of a thoroughly confused criminal.
And you actually believe this?
I see you detected one remaining footprint of fire. What happens if the burglar enters whilst you're in the house? Well, these tins also make for very handy weapons. All you've got to do is sneak up behind the burglar and bash him in the back of the head. If Madam will turn around, I'll be more than happy to demonstrate.
Yes, you've certainly shown me quite enough already, thank you.
Well, the modern police force is happy to have solved your problem today, Madam. If you'd be so kind to leave a Google review when completed, and please rate the service you've received today.
That would be difficult, given that my computer was stolen. But I will give you top marks if you will just please, at this stage, arrange a lift home.
Well, I do have a spare stretcher and a spare clone, but there is a problem. Regulations say if you're to be carried by just the one officer, you'd need to be strapped in.
I just want to get home now, so that's fine.
Well, that's not the problem, mate. You see, in order to securely strap you in, you'd need to be wearing a straight jacket. And, unfortunately, we have a limited number of things due to the budget. And I just gave our last one to a lovely old lady who was mugged.
Just a strip. Straight jackets. Could they not give an inappropriate impression of the police?
I'm not sure what you mean, madam. Research has shown that wearing a straitjacket is the safest form of travelling on a solo operated stretcher. And when the modern police force gets rolled out nationwide, we'd be advising all citizens to carry their own straitjackets for their safety and convenience. But in the meantime, I don't suppose you have one handy?
I'll walk.
Oh, so long, madam. Have a pleasant day. Oh, Stealth Officer Hanson. I didn't expect to see you back so soon.
The interval, you have a cheeky 15 minutes to grab a libation and use the facilities. There is a bar downstairs, but there will be a bell, and when that bell rings, please come back up for Act 2. Thank you very much. Enjoy the second half.
Just open the notes on the door. Open the notes on the door,
yeah.
Sarah was not happy. You can hear that stuff from miles.
Well, best be off. Got a date myself.
Of course you do.
James. Good luck. See you later, Nick. Where's he off?
With a girl, of course. Well, well, well.
What do you think?
Who cares?
Thank you.
I've always had this problem of taking things a bit too far. Too far for my own good. I can't help it. I can't see it. The edges, the boundaries, you know. Those places where you should just stop and think, really think, what's best? Other people, my own well-being. It's led me places. Places that I never wanted to go. You'll be smacked around a bit. Probably kicked out of jobs, kicked out of school. Got me in trouble with the law, the authorities, landlords, family, bouncers, neighbours, taxi drivers, in that dickhead in Cope Run in Tesco. Just because I didn't know when to stop, when to chill out, when I had enough, when to not argue, when to not hit someone, when I had enough booze, drugs, violence. You can guess where I ended up. When I got out of STD session, had to. I didn't mind. Can be the best time to listen. You do learn a lot, though. I could see there was something with me that was broken. The session was run by a bloke called John. He called himself John 2, but must be John 1. He was nice. It sucked. You have to be, don't you? To deal with people like that. John 2 tried to tell me that I wasn't broken. But there was nothing wrong with him. I was just missing something. What? I said. That's for you to find out, John. So over the weeks, over the months, I'm restless. I need something, a direction, anything, anything other than the booze, drugs, and all that. So I asked John, but who are your heroes, John? Oh, I don't know, I ain't right. What do you think of as the villain? Standing up to stuff, maybe? And who do you think of when you think of heroes? Him from Star Wars, maybe? Why? Why?
Let me think.
Why is that? Why is Luke Star Wars a hero? I mean, yeah, he's got a lightsaber magic. No one else has that, do they? And his hand's so long. He's just in it for the money. I mean, yeah, he gives up Fever for the rebels, but he wouldn't do anything without that Wookiee, would he? Then there's princess. She's different. And yeah, she's a princess, but she's a general too. She goes into the fight, picks up the guy and fights for what's right. She's smart, she's funny, she's confident. She sees the big picture. It took me by complete surprise when I realised Princess Leia is my hero. So I went back to my life and I thought, what would Princess Leia do? What would she do? What could I do to be like her? So I looked out for the little guy and I fought for her. I looked out for those who needed help and I helped them. I searched around to see if there was anything, anything I could do to help, to keep people safe. Roy told me that. Has awful things like racist, disgusting. We'll leave him alone. All she wanted to do was play with her son in the park. We wouldn't leave him be. So I found him. I found him leaving his nice office job, his nice three-piece suit. He got the 76 home. So I got the 76 home. He walked down Anglesey Avenue, so I waited. I waited till it got dark. By the window, watching him settle in for the night. And I went up to his door, and knocked. I tried to speak to him, bit of reason, but it wouldn't go through his thick fucking skull, would it? When the police came, they said he was lucky to be alive after I was done with him, didn't they? Just like those old Saturday nights, huh? I tried to be like Princess Leia. I tried to be smart, confident, witty. But I was still that same angry me. The same me who needed booze, drugs, and violence. That same old habit. John 2 wasn't disappointed. John 2 understood what I did. John 2 said I could have more than one hero. He asked me if I'd ever read anything by Carrie Fisher, you know, the burning plate. Which is like...
She's written a lot, you know, John. You might like it. I'll speak to your diagnosis and speak to where you are.
So for the first time in years, I bought a book. I bought three. I bought more than just books that opened my eyes like hers did. But books that taught me that other people were like me. Other people were depressed. Other people were addicted. Other people were angry for no reason. And although you might feel broken, you might feel lost, that feeling might never, ever go away. You're not going to. Funny, isn't it? Would you imagine a bloke like me looking up to a bird like her? I found this thing that she interviewed online. I found it. I want to read it to you. That's why Star Wars is appealing. You watch someone fight a perilous monster. All of us are looking for an outside ordeal that will internally change. A cause or a person to play out the psycho drama. We replace the fairy tale monster with a human being. We find a human monster to live with. You engage with somebody else to resolve your need for psychotrauma. And you try to overcome them in the conflict rather than trying to overcome that thing in yourself. You forget you pick these people or that person to work out your own conflicts. And if you recognise that, it gets easier. You get to choose what monsters you want to save. I'm sorry to say this again, but let's face it. The Force is with you.
Waiting for aliens.
That's amazing. That's why I'm here too.
wanted to make sure. Plus, I like things.
I might even go naked. I'm open to anything.
This is possible. None of this is real. Someone is playing a trick on you. Aliens don't just kind of carry you away.
It happened to me already.
It did not.
3 years ago. I was walking down the street at night, and then suddenly, I'm flying through the air, and then I'm in this spaceship, and there are these, like, freaky-looking aliens with big eyes, like, poking at me and stuff. They didn't, like, cut me open or anything. They just took my temperature in your mouth. Like, damn it.
Anal probe!
They just took my temperature! Okay, so it hurt a little bit more than the doctor.
It was an anal probe.
It was not that bad. I had a boyfriend.
Oh, stop! I don't want to hear about that. Look, why would the two of you want to go up there and have them do things to you?
They said they were going to take me to their planet.
Mine, you said that too.
But why would you want to go to their planet?
Are you kidding me? Why wouldn't I want to go to their planet? I mean, just look at the world right now. All the craziness,
the hate,
the global warming, the fighting. This planet is doomed!
I just broke up with my boyfriend.
That's not a good reason.
That's why I didn't go with them in the first place. They wanted to take me, but I thought me and Jeremy were going to work out. But he's such a child, I'm going back to space.
What's global warming? The melting ice caps? Oh, something real. Something interesting. I want to be an ambassador of love for humanity. You think the planet's going to be amazing, right?
Yeah. They seem really nice, even the butt stuff is gentle.
So, where are they?
They aren't coming.
I think it's his bad energy. You need to leave.
I'm staying right here.
Then we'll go. Come on.
This is ridiculous. You can stay over there all night if you want to. I'm going to stay right here and make fun of you.
Some guys like to talk. So
feel like they need to justify. What do they say? Well, it's fascinating.
I can write a thesis about it. I mean, like, some of these guys have no problems meeting ladies in real life. Well, I've looked him up. He's a okay-looking, successful man. He's rich too. Can't wait for me. But their problem is, see, so watching these videos online. We've got porn on tap, right there. They can find anything they can possibly imagine. Absolutely anything. Some things they could never possibly imagine. Anyway, so what this means is, meeting the exact girl they want in real life, and I mean like the exact girl, well, that's not too easy. And even if they do meet the exact life girl, you know, getting them into the same positions and to do the same things as these doppelgangers in their porn videos, well, that's pretty rare too. Great business, that's what it means. No, sure, yeah. Sometimes I worry, you know, about what it means for, you know, birth rates or whatever. Not too many people on this planet anyway. Like, global warming, overpopulation. Guess what I do? Sell a double service. Yeah. Everybody wins. But sometimes, guys have a different story. You know, just the other day, I took this call, started off as usual, he wanted to order Jessica. We give all the girls real names. It helps build an instant connection with the customer. Anyway, so, started off like usual, he wants to order Jessica, and I start telling him about all the options. You know, hair, and clothes, fingernails. When I ask him if he wants the option of a removable vagina, you know, fully machine washable, easy to clean, etc. He says he doesn't want to know. No, he says, you know, don't tell me about that. It's not about that at all. Here we go. Another story. Then he starts talking. See, his sister's called Jessica. Well, she was called Jessica. The face on our Jessica looks just like hers. It's uncanny, he says. But the real Jessica, his Jessica, died many years ago. And his mum, Jessica's mum, is 80-something now, and she lives in home. She's got dementia. No memories for her. And for the first few years it was alright, you know, he felt like she was maybe safe in the home, maybe even happier. But then her memory starts fading. One day she wakes up, she's terrified, and he's had to watch this woman, his mother, change and slowly slip away. Now she often doesn't even respond when he talks. She just can't follow what he's saying. So to make it to her, he brings up memories of the old days, back to when her memory was intact. When he does this, that's when her eyes come to life again. She gets carried away and he gets his mum back. But over the last few years, she started asking about Jessica. Where is she? Where's my daughter? And he's had to tell her. Jessica's dead. Well, Jessica's still dead. And the next time he goes in. And the next time. Imagine that. Imagine having to tell your mum of her own daughter's death. Again. And again. And every time she cries. Every time. So, anyway, he wants our Jessica, Jessica the perfect partner, so he can take to the home. So every time his mum asks for Jessica, he can just say, you know, don't worry, Jessica's here, Jessica's right here. And our Jessica thinks can stay the way they were. His mum can stay carried away.
listen to the story for maybe 20 minutes or more. And it really got me. And it made me think. Who am I? Me, you, any of us. Who are we? Are we just what we can hold on to now? What we see in front of us? What we hear? What we feel? I don't think so. I think it has to be more than that. It has to be our memories. You know, everything we've seen, everything we've done, isn't that who we are? These memories, they're just a stamp on our brain, a temporary alignment of brain cells. The idea that one day I'll try, but I won't be able to find that stamp, you know, those memories. And if I can't find them, then what else am I? That's what gets me. Losing everything. Not just your memories. Everything that you are. Everyone that you know. Your whole existence. And watching someone struggle and slip away. Watching them try and find themselves. And you do anything to help. And sometimes all it takes is Jessica. Right? Propped up in a chair. Jessica?
insane. Say something! Show us your beauty! No! Shit! Oh.
Thank you. son has a Nintendo Wii. There's a bit where you can go skiing. That'll be good fun. Does that count?
Not really, Mum, no. Sorry.
What is it you folks use these days? Xbox isn't the like ours now.
Yeah, the Squadron's got a couple of PS4s for downtime.
And they're good, aren't they?
Yeah, it depends on the game, but they're great. Mum, have I really fucked up? it was a mistake, and I'm really sorry. Things just got a bit heated, but it was a complete one-off, I promise.
We'll see.
I couldn't face people back home. Mum, if I got kicked out, I could never look my dad in the eye.
One thing at a time. Let me make some notes, we can get a timeline started. So you started your shift tonight when?
2100 hours.
And what do you work? 3 hours in the container and one off?
Yes.
And how do you find it? Difficult, hard or curious?
No more than flying a real plane, once you get used to it.
What time would you say the game started? Around... midnight, you say, after your first stint?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
And the game was? The devil's in detail, I was told.
Call of Duty, Mom.
And that's a good one, is it?
Oh, brilliant.
And then you said, Sweeney grabbed the controller.
Well, yeah, when he saw I was about to beat the high score, yeah.
And what time would that have been?
Maybe 20 past 12, half past 12, something like that.
And then we arrived.
Yes. Mom, please. I think I just need you to
see.
Mom.
It's just gone 2300 hours. You never left that container. Not until Sweeney dragged you out.
Down.
Continue.
Every night, I fall down a rabbit hole into a sort of wonderland.
In our dreams, our suppressed imagination can break free. All of your behaviour is controlled by your unconscious mind. So tell me, Alice, more about this wonderland.
It's inhabited by talking creatures who shouldn't be talking at all. First, I meet a white rabbit, dressed in a funny costume, carrying a giant pocket watch.
Go on.
He's quite distraught. He's late for an appointment with a very mean queen. If her subjects don't play by her rules, it's off with their heads!
And how's your relationship with your master? Would you describe her as demanding of stern temperament?
Well, I don't really understand.
It is natural for a girl to beg into womanhood to resist authority.
So tell me more about Sir Rabbit.
It's all very jumbled. There's a massive caterpillar named Absalom smoking from a hookah.
Caterpillar, snake, sexual suppression.
Your interaction with this creature, does it make you feel frustrated?
Yes! He talks in riddles. And that cat. A Cheshire cat with a grin from ear to ear. I ask him for simple directions. Cheshire cat, would you tell me please which way I ought to go from here? He replies, that depends which way you want to go! Ridiculous creature.
And do you have a natural aversion to cats?
Why no. In my nightmare, if it wasn't for chasing after my cat, I would have fallen into the rabbit hole. Then there are the pills.
What type of pills?
One pill makes you larger, and one pill makes you smaller.
A curious phenomenon.
Exhausting!
Let us review. Would you agree that chasing your cat down to the rabbit hole was rash behaviour, and that you have not considered your unfavourable trip to this wonderland?
I can't control my nightmares, can I?
Yeah, but you can see the correlation between the waking state and the dream.
Oh, now you're talking jabberwocking.
Jabberwocking?
Gibberish!
Now, listen here,
you... Look at you, see here! I didn't come to have you meddling about with the state of my waking mind! I came here to have you slay my dream demons!
Petulant, Harvey. Perhaps you should examine your reality with closer scrutiny. Perhaps you should acknowledge that your curiosity has ramifications.
I didn't choose to have this dream.
Still resistant to authority, still hostile towards the rules. Sit down, Alice. Take a deep breath. Yeah, feel better? Let us continue. So how does this dream end?
I wake up sitting under a tree.
Oh, advise a young woman from the experience.
I am.
Yeah, this dream is a mere metaphor for exploring the unknown, for coming of age.
It is?
Yeah, in future psychoanalysis, we will delve deeper into your psychosis and get to the roots of your anxiety dream disorder.
Psychosis? Dream anxiety disorder?
I'm quite confident we'll put these dream demons to their final rest. We'll have our next session, same time next Wednesday. But in the meantime, I've written your prescription. Take 30 minutes before bedtime.
Thank you. I really do want to get better.
Case study for Sir Ages!
We'll be right back.
This is my corner, you freak! I've been working this work for the last 8 months, and it belongs to me! You calling me crazy? Get out my damn corner now! I'm not fooling around. Get off my damn corner now! Okay, if that's the way it's gonna be, you proud of bouncing around, I'm gonna teach you a lesson. You're clever? You think you're tough? Well, you just bet too much. Not so brave now. Eat lead mine! You think you've outsmarted me? Well, think again. Say your prayers. You strict corner here. It's time to meet your mind brethren in heaven. All those years in mindful and doing you good. There are my mother. Thank you.